Welcome everyone to this month's webinar at NewGenP. So thank you for everyone for joining and joining our topic of managing risk in agile environments with Dan Roman. My name is Peter Monkhouse, so I'll be one of your hosts. I'm joined by my colleague, Joanna Tivick, who I will turn over in a moment the program to. Just so you know that we are recording this session and it will be posted for you to review on our website, newgenp.com. So I think with that, Joanna, over to you to introduce Dan, and then we'll get started.
Thank you so much, Peter. And I just wanted to mention that this is our last webinar before the holidays, before the summer holidays. So I'd like to thank you, Dan, for being with us. So, and just transitioning us to the summer vacations.
Of course, Joanna, remember, Dan is based in Australia, so he's moving to his winter.
Yeah. It is very cold. It's like 20 degrees. So.
Okay, so we love 20 degrees. So Dan is joining us from beautiful Australia. He's in Sydney, and I'm hoping one day I can visit him because we've been dreaming about this. I have relatives there, so I would be so happy to go there. And because he's in Sydney, it's already June 12th, so we wanted to also wish Peter happy birthday, Peter. You know, many, many years to come and to do these things together. So thank you for all our partnership. We are so excited to have you here because not only that we share our native background, that we are both Romanians and we moved to foreign lands and we made them our own, but just because we share passion for Agile. And I was going through your profile and I was thinking about my profile because I think we both started managing projects, waterfall projects. I worked in PMO, you worked in PMOs, you've been helping organizations since then, understanding different ways of working. And I've seen that you've done business transformations, digital transformations, and basically, you know, sharing that passion that we have for getting things done. So without more about this, I'd like to pass it on to you and welcome you here. And I'd like to invite everybody to ask you as many questions and tell us as many stories about how Agile is done, you know, like in Australia and that area, because I think we have so much to learn from you. So thank you again.
So before Dan gets started, I'd just like to interject as well. So Dan, besides the accomplishments that Joanna mentioned, Dan is also a very active volunteer with PMI. He runs a monthly series of webinars on projectmanagement.com, and I attended many of them. Unfortunately, I can't get to all of them. And he's really very insightful about Agile, about his point of view around Agile. And in fact, he has his next one coming up on July 23rd about the Agile Enterprise, project roles and responsibilities in Agile. So I'm not sure I'm gonna be able to make it to that one, but anyway, looking forward to it. I do encourage you to go and listen to his wisdom. The other thing I'd just like to mention and congratulate Dan is he was recently awarded the PMI Volunteer of the Year for 2020 in recognition of his volunteer efforts in PMI, and particularly in the Agile community. So congratulations, Dan. Having been a volunteer for many years myself, I know it's hard work, I know it's rewarding work, and I'm so pleased that people like you get recognized for the work that you do that makes the PMI and the profession so valuable. So thank you. So with that, we'll now let you go over, and now we've told you all these great things and set you up for the session. We'll now turn over and let you share some of your wisdom with our friends here are attending.
Okay, so let's find the right screen. It's nice when you are a former developer and you have a lot of screens. So I hope that you can see the scary part of my presentation. That's the only scary part. So just a bit of profiling now that I was so nicely painted. I started my career in manufacturing, and I still believe that at that time, very many, many years ago, we were doing a more mature Agile than I see now in some of the places that I work. I'm an independent contractor, so I go from place to place, which is good. I work sometimes in the PMO, sometimes in the business, sometimes in IT. Very interesting journey. And that series of the Agile Enterprise, it's my attempt to share my experience of coming from a developer, development manager, and moving to project management and seeing Agile at different scales. So a lot of material in this presentation, it's from some of my webinars. So what I want to speak about today, and please put a lot of questions at the end, because I do these webinars to learn from questions from other people's experience. One is, if there is such thing as an Agile risk management, what do you mean by risk and uncertainty, and a lot of terms that are used in risk management, and how we can bridge the gap between enterprise risk, high level risk, you know, the people that are with the board, and down to the Scrum team, to developers or people that now are not so related to software development, but they are using Agile frameworks. And part of that bridging the gap, it's establishing the context of risk management, focus on the project, the whole project, and the boundaries of risk management. This is a disclaimer. I know that this is more or less related to the PMI, or I'm more or less associated with PMI. This is my view, it's not PMI's view. It's based on my experience. Everybody has their own experience. I was lucky or crazy to move around in my career around a lot. So I work in Bahrain for 6 years. I work in France for 1 year, then I came to Australia. So very interesting journey. Not everybody will have the same kind of journey. So if my view is not the same as other people, it's because I have a different perspective. And very important when I do this webinar is to say that I'm looking at Agile from two completely different perspectives. One, it's Agile in manufacturing that started in the 80s. And it's a very mature practice, but it's not very well known. My view is that manufacturing is decades ahead of software development in terms of Agile. It's also the scale of manufacturing when you speak about tens of thousands of people involved in this Agile enterprise. And it's also interesting, especially for people that are joining now the Agile community, to know that in the beginning, Agile was a replacement of Lean. And we can see now Lean coming as a replacement of Agile in some frameworks. Why I was so passionate about risk management in Agile is because this is the view I took from some posts on LinkedIn, how people see project managers that are just talking about risk, and they spend days and week talking about risk and logging and doing stuff with risk and so on. While in an Agile team, we don't do these things. These things are not important because we manage risk versus de-risk, which I don't know what it means. But apart from being funny, it's true. There are two different perspectives about risk and risk management. The higher you go, the bigger is the project, the budget, the complexity, the more you need to learn risk. The smaller the team, the nicer and the focused domain, the harder is to believe that something will go wrong and you need to manage that thing. And now there is a suite of slides where basically I sort of make fun of how some very famous posters portray risk in waterfall and Agile. First of all, waterfall, it's a software development method that was defined in the 70s. And in my view, that paper is more Agile than some scaled frameworks. It speaks about feedback loops. It speaks about continuous customer involvement. it speaks about prototyping, but people stop at the first page, which is presented as a scarecrow. And to be honest, and it's not something that I see wrong, Agile is more faith-driven development from the risk perspective than the planned approach. This picture in on the right doesn't make any sense because risk doesn't go that way. There is no such function that going in steps. And whoever did this poster, they put the goal at the same place. So regardless if we use waterfall or Agile, we reach the same goal, which what the customer is looking for. I was expecting if I was selling Agile in and risk in Agile to have that goal achieved faster and cheaper, which is not always the case. Another graph that it's very similar. I don't understand, to be honest, how the value gets so incrementally growing, why the risk is between cost and value only. And another thing that I keep preaching when I speak about Agile is that iterative and incremental doesn't mean Agile. It was done from 70s, basically before the waterfall was defined. And that famous picture with the scooter and car and so on, it's just a very good illustration of waste in product development. Because if I'm a customer and I want a car, you give me a car, not a scooter. This is just, again, you know, different perception of different people about how the risk is in waterfall and Agile. So when I saw this graph first in a presentation, as the presenter, do you have any data that stay behind your graph? There is no data. And I finally found the graph. It's about completely different things than risk. But the simple fact that we have so many shapes and there is no science behind them, it's a risk in itself. Then I saw this thing when this is one of the sales pitches in Agile that we release fast and frequent and then we have less risk. I don't believe that it's true. And if I look at this graph, I'll be very happy to know that the risk is so linear. In my life, is never like that and so predictable that it grows, then comes to zero and so on. Similar thing, if we look at this graph, technically, in the smoother effort, less risk, we have a constant risk. So we are always at risk, even if it's a bit smaller. But at the end of the day, the second graph has the same outcome, which is not true. So either way, sometimes predictive is better than planned. Sometimes plan is better than predictive, but it's not that black and white or green and red. Something that I strongly advise against based on my knowledge in risk management, something that maybe is not in my profile. I did a degree in risk management by research, a master. And I learned so much from risk professionals. I was just an outsider. I was still a project manager. That one of the hardest things in risk management is to aggregate risks. They are never that simple to add. And this, I assume it's a real risk burn down. In this project, the highest risk, it's just the delivery or servers on time. And in project management, we all know that the hardest thing to manage are the people, not the technology, not servers, not infrastructure. I don't see anything that it's related to people in this graph, which is again a risk if you don't know even what risks you have in the project. This is also funny that at some point all the risks become higher and then suddenly they go to zero. Risk never go to zero. In any project, there is a residual risk that you pass to the customer. And that risk is usually as high as it was during the project. Again, the famous risk burn down chart that it's probably inspired by the burn down chart that comes from XP, and it's now very commonly using Scrum. It's another thing that I tried to get to that ideal shape, and I always failed. With any tool that I use, the Jira, DevOps, Excel, it's because the data collection is so hard to get to that shape. People are not putting their cards. They don't estimate. So I think the whole burn down chart, it's something that should be avoided because it's part of introducing risks in any project. Sometimes people spend so much time on that nice graph that they forgot what they should do for the project. And this is something that, unfortunately, different than project management and enterprise risk management, is still perceived in Agile. Risk is bad. It has a negative outcome. So some people are still in 1921 in terms of understanding risk. The other stuff that is in that book is that we use probability from 0 and 1 to assess risks. What is still true, it's the uncertainty that it's associated with risk. We can't predict risk. We can't accurately forecast, like I've seen in a training presentation, that if you do that training and use that framework, you can accurately predict how long the product backlog will take to be delivered. This is the stuff that I fully agree that it should be changed. This is how risk management it's done in a very conservative organization with a very formal approach. And yes, it looks fun, it looks good, but reality is that it will never be followed, this thing, so people will bypass. Especially when you come up with a risk register that has a lot of things and you'll spend maybe one day for each risk to put in the risk register. And probably that's why when they did this survey, they found out that half of the people that are doing risk management in projects are doing it just as a compliance thing. So they have to tick a box. Yes, I have a risk register. Yes, I'm managing risk. I was a PMO manager, and I did something that people didn't like, so I was agile. I started doing ad hoc audits, risk audits, and people told me, Dan, this is not the way we do things here. We have an audit at the end of the project. The PMO guy comes and asks, where is your risk register? Yes, you have a risk register. Tick the box. We did risk management. And it's bad because not only that you don't manage risk, it's also bad because you waste resources by doing risk just as a compliance thing. So Agile is new and requires a new approach to risk management. I don't believe that it's different than what was in the tradition as objectives. It's different in the way we manage risk, but we still need to manage risk for the same reasons like we do in a traditional approach. This is a slide from a presentation about my view on agile project management. And it's about the structure of a project and how the unknown and risk it's changing during the project. So first of all, an agile project should have a much shorter initiation time, because we don't spend a lot of effort and resources in planning in detail, estimating and all that stuff. We do a brief estimation, we need a vision, and then we can start even at just immediately after the charter, which describes the project objectives. So we don't need to wait for the sign-off project management plan. It's not the certification. And then we start building, and then at some point we need to hand over to operations, which is something that a lot of people forget, because many Scrum teams are basically maintenance teams, so they never stop. It's not a project, it's just a product development that goes over and over. And again, if we really want to be agile, we should dedicate most of the time in the project to the build. And then, because in agile, if we do retrospectives and we capture lesson learned and we improve as we go, we will have a much smoother, we should have much smoother closing phase and shorter. From the risk perspective, things are a bit different than people are trying to sell. In a traditional planned approach, risk will go down because we have a risk plan, we identify risk and so on. And the scope, it's firm, fixed, and you need a formal change control process to change the scope. In Agile, the scope is changing as we go, and that's how it should be. But with change comes unknown, and everybody who managed an Agile project in a large organization knows that towards the end of the project, people start panicking. We don't have enough money to finish because see the backlog now, it's so long and it will take so much time. And if we compare what we did now with what we used to do, we used to do much more, and now the backlog is so long and we don't have money. It's because, one, you change your mind, and when you draw the line, you have the same feature that you had 2 months ago. And second is because in traditional project management, you don't add anything to the scope. That's why the change control process is implemented. Again, this is my experience, and this is why I keep comparing the large-scale Agile that came from 1980s in manufacturing to the team Agile, the Agile that was popular or is popular after the Manifesto for Agile Software Development. In my view, and I'm very happy that I foresee in the future, like in the first slide, I drew this one in 2016, actually. I think Agile in 2020 reached the peak. And if we look at all the so-called scaled Agile frameworks, they are basically a return to lean. They have a lot of lean practices that people think that they are agile. And the best example for this return to efficiency and lean, it's DevOps, that people think it's a next step in Agile, or Kanban, which is again the next step. Both of them are pure lean practices. There is nothing agile in Kanban or in DevOps. It's eliminating waste, which is always an inhibitor for agility. And something that people forget, especially the developers, is that we are there as a company to make profit. And as Peter Drucker said, the business of business is to stay in business. The big difference between Agile and Lean, in Lean, people are still obsessed with perfect quality. So 4 defects in 1 million opportunity is something that in software development will never be achieved, and people should not even try to do that, because that means that you basically don't have any defects. In manufacturing, it can be, and it was achieved, but at the cost of losing the adaptability. And in today's market, when things are changing so fast and the customer are so savvy and they want features, they don't want quality as much as they used to do. So you don't buy a phone for life or a car for life. You buy a car for 3 to 5 years, depending how often you want to be seen as changing your car. So these days, the cost of delay could be much, much higher than the cost of quality. You can come up with a product that is not very good, but you get to the market and people buy your product, they can't jump to another product that often. And you can come up with a very good product, but because the market is now already saturated with not so good product, you lose the opportunity to make profit. And it's also similar case when you come to market too early with a very or too innovative product. And I always recommend people to watch a documentary called General Magic. It's about a company that failed, and it's called the most influential company in Silicon Valley that nobody heard of. they came up with a mobile phone in 90s and the company failed because they didn't assess the risk of coming with that product too early in the market. They were so convinced that what they do is fantastic and it's new, innovative, and they are the best developers, and they were some of the best developers in Silicon Valley. Most of them are vice presidents in large corporations, connected to eBay, which is byproduct. The guy was just a service desk guy. A lot of devices. Somebody was an advisor to the US president. So fantastic people, but the company failed because they didn't have any risk assessment if the market is ready or is not ready for the product. So the risk is in both in quality and in the delay. And this is something that I was really surprised when I saw that one of the new frameworks that it's called Scaled and Enterprise Agile and so on, came back with the House of Lean. House of Lean has nothing to do with Agile unless we introduce agility in that house. And I put with red what I see the change that Agile should bring to the House of Lean. One is that instead of standardized processes, the processes should be evolving. Standardization helps very much in eliminating risk, variance, and all that thing, but it will inhibit adaptability. So we need to add adaptability to market, to process, to technology, to everything. And then unlike Lean, in Agile, we need to be risk-friendly. So we need to take risks because risk, it's what Agile is all about. It's change. So Agile, it is change-friendly, but any change comes with risk. So that house of Agile Enterprise, it's a combination of Lean, that is the foundation of any successful enterprise because that's efficiency, and Agile, which is the adaptability to market and any other changes that comes in life, and they come too often now. So this is how it looks from the Lean perspective. So very surprised for some people that flow and quality and less waste, these are pure Lean things that were studied for maybe almost 100 years. And then we get with the Agile component and we adapt to the market and we reduce the time to market. And that will improve the bottom line, the return of investment. Unfortunately, everything comes with risk. The moment you introduce changes, then you put at risk most of these things. So even in Agile, we need to manage risk. And this is a real project. So I was the PM in a project that involved three Scrum teams. Each Scrum team was developing their own almost competitive product. They were competitors. So we put, we open a data feed for these three companies to develop mobile applications that we roll out in that government agency. So they were competitors in a way, each one with his own product. From the company's perspective or government's perspective, it was a risk mitigation that if one product is not successful, you have two more. So government can afford to do these things. And the Scrum teams were pretty small. Only one of them had seven people. The other one had only three people, one had five. And everything was very nice and very simple from the Agile Scrum point of view. And as we can read in the guide, Agile incremental approach, small, optimize the risk and improve predictability. The actual project looked a bit different, a bit with quotes. That small application was part of the much bigger picture where the organization wanted to transform the people in the train station to get out from their office and use that application to become a sort of travel agents, advisors to the public, And also when there was a problem, to have the information at their hands and just tell people what to do. To do that on a large scale, you need to enroll all the mobiles in the enterprise platform, the MDM. You need to get that data feed from the operations to see when the train is coming, when there is a problem. You need to speak with IT, which was not much involved because they didn't have the mobile application development team. It was a huge change management effort to tell people that never used the mobile for work, that now they have to have a mobile with them all the time. Of course, you had to buy mobiles. They had to change the uniforms to have holster for the mobiles, and also as part of a bigger change plan to show how the organization is transforming. There was another project that was doing a similar thing with tablets. So my part was only mobiles, and we all had to report to the PMO. And the enterprise risk management team was also involved because a lot of money, a lot of visibility, a lot of reputation risk, and everything was part of a big transformation. And they had their own program, not as big in terms of people, but as big in terms of importance and vision. So when I start looking at risk from agile perspective, it's always good to go back to standards, because in essence, standards are frameworks. Scrum can be a very good standard in itself. I don't know why nobody tried to make that effort, because it's a huge effort to make it an international standard. So in risk management, there are three important standards. One is called COSO, one is ISO, and PMI has his own risk management standard. And then there is nothing formal about risk in Scrum or Agile. I take the Scrum guide as the de facto standard for Agile. There are many surveys, and more than 50%, sometimes 70, 80, 90%, they think that they do Scrum, or they really do Scrum. But Scrum is the de facto the framework that any Agile team will use. Every scaled framework starts with Scrum as the foundation. So from the content and the target of that standard, COSO, it's a very board-oriented. It's at the high level, top level, mainly financial risk, reputation, so something that impacts the company as a whole. The ISO, it's a standard that covers everything. It's a generic standard for risk management, and it's a very good standard, not because it originated from Australia, but it originated in occupational health and safety, where risk is not as easy as in software development. If you do things wrong, people die. And that's why they wanted to make sure that there is a good framework and a good process to avoid fatalities or injuries. PMI has a standard that covers project, program, and portfolio. And I think that it's a bit redundant with the ISO. If ISO is covering the whole thing, why do we need a separate thing? And in Scrum, as far as I know, there is no risk management practice. There is a book that is called Agile Risk Management that has nothing to do with either risk or Agile. This is how COSO looks, and I put with green things that I see very relevant for Agile. So a lot of objectives of this framework are Agile. So attracting good people, changing the culture, big change, improvement, objectives. These are things that work for Agile and should be also in Agile. In Scrum, it's a bit different because it's an emerging framework. It was now, it's maybe some 10 years old. I think it's a very old and limited view on risk. One, because Scrum doesn't improve predictability. Agile, it's against predictability. We change as we need to change. So how you can predict and change at the same time. And people moved, and I'll show you later, from the controlling risk, as the risk is bad, to risk it's a good thing sometimes. And sprints will never limit the risk to one calendar month, of course, if the sprint is 1 month, because you can lose everything that you did in the previous sprints because one of the sprint, the last one, doesn't deliver a part of that product or service. And then the product or service doesn't go to production. So it's not that simple, that is limited only to the last sprint. And very, very important and risky is that we make decisions based on perceptions rather than based on numbers and science. And that's a big risk in itself. This is how a lot of starting people see Scrum. It's a very idyllic view where there are ideas, they become stories and epics. And then there is a backlog that should have product backlog items, not tasks and stories. And then we have a sprint backlog, we deliver feature to the user. It's fantastic. This is what the book said. Reality, it's a bit different. Ideas will be much more than you have money to implement. The poor product owner, it's expected to write stories, direct the whole activity, bring money, solve problems, and in parallel do his day job, because product owner is not a role that is so well defined for human resources or people and culture that somebody will do only what is required in the Scrum team. They will have usually, if it's a real product owner, a lot of other things to do, like strategy and managing a team of people that are doing product development, as in design. And then, of course, we go to the product backlog that grows and grows and grows. And some people put defects in the backlog, and they should put defects in the backlog because it's something that needs to be done to deliver the project. But the mistake that will introduce risk to delivery is to put value on the defects, because then the team, the Scrum team, the project team is just working and get paid to fix their own mistakes. And of course, when we deliver with a lot of undocumented features, and that's life. And I think this is something that people should explain about Agile, that the focus is not on quality. The focus is on coming fast to the market with the features that the customer need, not with something that was discussed 2 years ago and it's already obsolete by the time it's signed off. This is how ISO 31000 looks like. It was redone a few years ago. And they introduced the famous PDCA cycle from process improvement. And instead of being the traditional, we find the risk, we manage the risk, we treat, we communicate and consult, which it's very aligned with Agile, the communication, the visibility, the monitoring, very important in this standard and something that a lot of people forget when they do risk management, it's establishing the context. Is that stage where you decide how much risk you can take and what you manage and what you don't manage and why. And the new standard, it's also, it's a process improvement thing using risk. Again, back to small teams of, let's say, Scrum. People forget that the development team is not the biggest team in a normal standard organization. I had a webinar and I put numbers on these triangles. And in that organization, the development team was of 5 people. The IT in itself had around 200 people. And the company had 5,000 people. So out of 5,000, we had only 5 developers. Many Agile frameworks are developed by developers, software developers, for software developers. They are not meant to be used in the business, in projects, and so on. So we should be very careful when we try to implement an Agile framework mindset or whatever to to the whole organization, because that push, it's a big risk for the success. You go to the Agile mindset, which is very good, and I'm a big fan of it, to procurement or legal or accounting. They don't understand where is the benefit of changing your mind every 5 minutes and doing what the customer wants rather than what you have on a piece of paper. So when we look at Agile, risk, and enterprise, we should take into consideration how the other people are looking at risk and agility. And this is where things get very confused. You speak with a Scrum team, they said, we have a risk burndown chart. You speak with a traditional project management office or project manager, and they will show you the risk register with a lot of colors, with a lot of tools. But in essence, it's the same thing. It's a list of risks that some people are making some use of it. Some people are just having it. And then on the left side, there is the simulation, the Monte Carlo simulation on schedule, on cost, on anything. A very scientific approach that I just had the chat with a few people that are trying to do this in Agile, and I keep telling them that it's useless, because to do modeling, you need a lot of data, and Agile doesn't have any reliable data, because it shouldn't have. You change your mind, no single product or project it's similar or too similar with another one. So you can't compare them. You can't use that historical data for modeling. So the problem with the risk management is that at different levels in the organization, risk it's, it has different objectives, the risk management. At the top end, the focus is on the business, the whole business, the core. So in the project is just for that project. So as a project manager, yes, we do care about the impact of the project failure to the organization, but we don't want to fail the project. That's the main focus. And then at the Scrum team, and most of the Agile frameworks, the team is focusing on a product. And that's how it should be. You don't use a product development framework to manage projects. And because of this kind of different view on risk, then the vocabulary used is different. Severity levels are completely different between the Scrum team and the board. If you ask a Scrum team member how much will cost a big risk, they show a big risk, it's 1 month worth of work. So let's say it's $10,000, $15,000. You go to the board and you tell them that you need to discuss 5 minutes about the $10,000 risk. And they'll say in 2 minutes, we spend more than $10,000 just talking about that $10,000 risk. And then it's not clear who is responsible for what in risk management at different levels, especially in the Scrum teams, because somebody said that the project manager role is split between PO, Scrum Master, and development team, developers. Then basically the whole responsibility for risk is going away. And as I said, risk is no longer perceived as bad, especially in Agile. It's a good thing to take risks. And there is a lot of misunderstanding and bad perception about risk and Agile. The solution is that we need to integrate Agile risk approach to the enterprise risk and teach people that risk can be positive. And I got that question many times. Give me an example, and I will give you an example if you want. And instead of adapting Agile practices to risk management, we need to adapt risk management practices to Agile. And one thing that Agile is very good at, it's delegation, sharing, and collaboration. First, the definition of risk is completely different between even the standards that people spend months doing them. I like the first one. It's that simple, so everybody can understand. It's what uncertainty does with our objectives. It's not about the project, the product, the enterprise, the whatever. We have objectives. Everybody has objectives. What will be the impact of what we don't know on these objects? Again, there is a bit of difference between what are the two components of risks. Some people think it's probability and impact. The ISO standard, the ISO standard says likelihood and consequence. And there is a big difference between the likelihood and the probability. For probability, you need a lot of data to get a number. Likelihood can be a very subjective thing. I think it's very likely, it's unlikely, and so on. So it's what Scrum does with the relative estimation, risk standard does with the risk estimation. It's a relative risk, and they call semi-quantitative risk. And this one, it's everybody's on the same page at the top of the town. That organization need to be more adaptive to change, which is exactly agility. And risk management is not for a department, for a team, for a person. It's spread across the organization. And it's much more than a risk listing, that famous risk register. So this is in the framework. This is how they started the new version of the board risk management. The risk management is very, very aligned with Agile, and even the so-called Agile manifesto, which is limited to software development, it's not talking about risk. We need to understand that Agile is always new, so it can't be prescriptive. It can't be, we do this because that eliminates risk using this framework. We have to learn by doing it. So yes, we take the risk. We made a mistake. We learn from that mistake, so we don't repeat when the impact will be much bigger. It is team-based risk in Agile. It doesn't need documentation, like the formal risk management with a lot of policy procedures, work instructions, risk register. And collaboration is not only with the customer, it's with everybody. But for me, the last line in the manifesto for Agile software development is the key of agility. It's responding to changeover following a plan, which still means that you need a plan, but you adapt as you go, and you don't blindly follow the plan because somebody said it's the best way to do it. So coming back to that big diagram, I see a much simpler approach in Agile. One is that everything is the team. So it's not a risk owner, it's not the Scrum Master, it's not the PO, it's the whole team that is looking at risk. And a lot of steps are unnecessary. Like we define strategies, we mitigate, we assign a risk owner. It's the team. And I'll show you a simple tool to help the team manage risk. And then whatever the team can't do, you escalate. And that's it. You don't need to check what that person did. If it's escalated, is their problem. So usually as a project manager, it's either escalated to me, so I'm above the team in terms of managing the risk. I do what PM does. And if I can't do it, I escalate to sponsors, to PMO, to somebody that it's much higher in the organization than me and can take tougher decisions. And that's no longer my problem. It's their problem. So it's outsourcing. So as I said, we need to understand that risk is just simple impact of uncertainty into the objectives. Everything else, it's fluffy and wrong. I built this pyramid based on a pyramid that is using safety. And the only message from this thing that I want people to remember is that for every major significant risk, there'll be thousands of small risks. And the moment we are aware of this small risk and we define a way to deal with them, we reduce the likelihood of a big problem. It was used in a company in occupation health and safety so well. What they did, they had safe act observations, so peer review. And based on the peer reviews, they improved the process. And they said, you know, the moment we find a lot of unsafe acts at that bottom level, we know that fixing them will avoid injuries or fatalities. So it can be aligned with Fibonacci, and each band will have a different strategy. The best strategy is the bottom. We just take that risk and we deal with it without even making a task, an action, or whatever. We are aware and we monitor. We are. If we can't do that, we need to have some contingency, either time or money or whatever, to deal with risks. And then we escalate everything else from an agile team above. So it's very important to know where the risk appetite for that organization is, so then we can align in the Scrum team. And then what is our capacity, including the project manager, to manage risk at the Scrum team level, because then whatever can't be done at the Scrum team level, it goes to the PM. They know what to do, or they should know what to do. And then there is above is the PMO, the steering committee, and then the enterprise level, we can escalate some risks. And it's good to define, you know, how much money we potentially lose because of that risk, if the risk happens. And also in Scrum, it's interesting to see projects that are 3 years, 4 years. That's not agile. That's very waterfallish planning, because nobody knows what will happen in the next 3 months. So the Scrum team should focus on the next 2-3 sprints. Everything that is beyond that one, it's the project managers and above problem. These are the strategies that are traditional, standard, or whatever. So there are risks at every level that will have the same strategy. Like, a lot of risks are just accepted and nothing happened with them. We don't need to manage every risk that somebody is raising. Some of them we just monitor, and there are just few that we take actions to either exploit or mitigate, which is reducing them. And then there is outsourcing, where we transfer the risk to somebody that is more powerful than us. This is the tool that I was talking. So instead of having a risk register, you can have a risk board where everybody puts sticky notes with what they think it's their concern on the delivery. So it's not related to product, to project, to anything. It's just, you know, people think that there might be a problem with something. And then when we have the stand up in the morning, we just move these stickies around. So the big area is stuff that we know somebody said we don't care, we put there. Some things that time to time we speak about them, so we monitor, we don't take any action, but we are aware that at some point they may move to another area. And then there are risks that we take advantage of. I don't want to speak about the bad ones, because everybody knows how to deal with the bad ones. But for example, something that people think that it's academic, is not academic. I put products in production without testing, or features or modules, because by putting that stuff in production fast, not only that the customer gets the benefit sooner, but I also get the feedback to make the product better and improve without wasting too much time. So I don't waste time to make it perfect. There will be defects. People will come. The trick is that you need to choose what can be delivered in that way, because you can't put a financial system without testing, but you can put a website, a team site, without any testing, because people will learn how to manage these problems either by themselves or sending back to the development team. And the team, the Agile team, the Scrum team, should be always aware that they can escalate to somebody else. So if the problem is something that may impact the team, the product, and they can't do anything, just escalate. And it's the job of either the Scrum Master or the PO to find out the right place to escalate. When there is a PM in that environment, give it to the PM. They will know what to do. And I think we are approaching the end. And that board can very easily be used in conjunction with the famous risk register. So above the Scrum team, the PM or whoever can just transfer that risk to the register and let them manage the way they do. And in conclusion, risk is very good for Agile. It's something that should be integrated with what the enterprise does in projects that are not Agile in the company as a whole. And I think that risk management profession, part of which is project management, should learn from the success of agile frameworks for software development by simplifying their process, by making a collaborative and team effort, and clarify who's responsible for what in terms of management of risks. The top end is responsible for the culture of the organization, which is the main reason for agile failures. When the culture is not a right fit for people taking risk, and when the top guy said failure is not an option, don't do agile. The project management, they need to define the strategy for the project. So what we do, what is a big risk, what is a small risk, and then let the Scrum team self-organize and self-manage and manage what they can manage. So my view on Agile is that the manifesto should be a bit considered as equal sides. We need processes and tools, and DevOps, it's a very good example that finally people understood that tools are defined and developed and made to help. We need that product, not only software, any product that we build and operational documentation. We need collaboration enterprise-wide, not only with the customer. And we don't need that many contracts. If we can get away with negotiation and have a much simpler piece of paper that still needs to be signed when there is money exchanging hands. And that responding to change should be very clear that is not without a plan. We need a plan, but we don't blindly follow the plan. So the both sides should be equally important and are equally important if we want to scale Agile beyond a small team of developer. Thank you. So that's it from me. Now I'll answer some questions if there are. And I don't know how the questions will come. Peter, help me with that, because I don't know, people will ask. In PMI, we get to the chat.
Yeah, absolutely.
But now we are not so many, so we can just talk.
Absolutely, Dan. And thank you very much. Very, very interesting. So we have a few minutes for questions. You can either open up your mics and ask them or just put them into the chat group. As Dan mentioned, we don't have a large number. So
yeah, let's say I can stay 10 minutes. So it's not the problem.
Okay, perfect. Very generous of you. So any questions at all? Well, maybe as we're waiting for people to collect their thoughts, you gave us a lot to think about. I know our friend David Hilson has been advocating about opportunities or positive risk events for years now. Maybe you could share an example from a project point of view of how you would see a positive risk and where you think as a project manager or product owner that risks are, we should worry about positive risks or think about positive risks as much as negative ones or more than negative.
So the whole Agile in itself, the whole approach, it's a positive risk. One, because moving to Agile, we don't know. We don't know what will happen. In some places, it fails. In some places, doesn't fail. And when it fails because people don't understand that they take a risk and they should be prepared to take that risk. But moving to a different approach will... So I'm 100% sure that most people will do things better using an agile approach than using a plan, than wasting time and waiting for the perfect product or service. And that's why in manufacturing in 80s, they said, okay, we have a perfect quality, we have very good processes, but we can't adapt. And that's the positive risk, jumping to something new, because with that something new, new technology, new process, new people, you can achieve faster your objectives. And by achieving faster, you achieve them, because sometimes you wait and wait and wait, and you won't get the profit. And as I said, I skip steps, which is a risk in itself. If you start with less design, if you put in production without testing, that's a risk, but it's a positive risk because the outcome of that action will be benefit for the team or for the organization.
Thank you. And I think it is something that we need to think about. After all, as you say, by using an agile approach, a different approach, we're doing it because we're thinking we're going to get more benefits for the organization, delivering value sooner, getting feedback. So it's a sense of a risk as well. One other question I have for you, as we see if anyone else has questions before we wrap up. You know, one of the things that when I first got exposed to project risks, that there was a discussion about, there are project risks and business risks. Right? As a project manager, I should only worry about my project risks. Or as a product manager, I need to only worry about the product risks. The other risks, you know, go away, someone else's problem. What are your thoughts about the integration on Agile around these project risks versus product risks or versus business risks?
So first of all, as I said, the whole organization should have a clear and same view on risk, what is big, what is small. I don't say that people should not care about, so if you are in the product, you don't care about project. If you are in the project, you don't care about the business. I think there should be awareness and collaboration, because the moment you say, I don't care about what's the impact of my failure to other downstream or to the organization. But the difference is in who will be responsible. So everybody should collaborate. But at the end of the day, if people don't understand who is responsible for what, you'll have problems. So a single vision at the enterprise level, what risk is, and what the levels of risk and who is responsible for each level, and collaborate. That's my view that should be done in an agile enterprise.
I agree. Collaboration. Who identifies the risk is not important. The fact that it is recognized that someone's looking at worrying about it or helping make it happen in the case of opportunity is what's important.
Okay. Yeah, and sorry, it's another thing that is specific to Agile or whatever looks like specific. It's the courage to speak about the risks. As a project manager, especially in very conservative organizations, I know about risks that I can't even talk about them. I can't put them in a register because they are associated with people that are important. Like, you know, a product owner that has no idea about the business, that's a big risk, but you can't put that one in the register. You can't speak with that. So you have to find a way to work with the team to mitigate that risk of the PO that doesn't take decision, doesn't provide direction in the terms of the product. And that's where the team collaboration comes very handy. If you don't need to tell the team that, you know, we are waiting for the guy to tell us what to do and he doesn't come or she doesn't come, let's do something. If everybody comes up with ideas, small ideas that will mitigate that risk, it's much, much easier than one guy trying to find solutions for everything.
Oh, excellent point. Thank you, Dan. Okay. Well, thank you everyone for attending. We'll just wrap up now. Thank you for attending and taking the time. Thank you, Dan, for the very thoughtful presentation with lots of great information. Really appreciate you sharing that with us. So this is our, as Joanna mentioned at the beginning, this is our last webinar for this season. We're going to take a couple of months off to regroup and refresh. Hopefully we can. And we'll be back in September with more topics and more great speakers. In the meantime, please visit us on our website, newgenp.com. You can contact us for a free virtual coffee. I mentioned that Dan is going to be on projectmanagement.com on July 23rd. Joanna and I will be speaking on projectmanagement.com this coming Thursday. My goodness, it's June 17th, about agility in a nutshell. So I think it's 2:00 in the afternoon, so you can look for us there. Again, don't hesitate to email us at info@newgenp if you have any questions or comments or just want to talk about anything. For those of us in the Northern Hemisphere, have a great summer. And we look forward to seeing you on our next webinar in September. Do keep in touch. Thank you.
Thank you very much, everybody.